Welcome to Thinking Out Loud, 30 minutes of thought-provoking conversation with UW-Sheboygan faculty. I'm Jackie Joseph Silverstein, Campus Executive Officer and Dean here at UW-Sheboygan and the host of today's show. I have with me Dr. James Cabral, who's been with us before and who you might know through his cool chemistry presentations that he does for kids each year. James is an associate professor in the chemistry department who came to us with a PhD from the University of Minnesota. James' thesis work focused on the biosynthesis of a putative anti-tumor agent. He's currently doing research, though, in the area of teaching and learning, making contributions to the field of teaching excellence as it relates to the teaching of chemistry. Today, James will be talking to us about pseudoscience and how he uses that to instill students with a sense of the importance of scientific literacy. And then we'll explore a specific example of the insidiousness of pseudoscience, and that is one that is a really important issue today. That's the issue around vaccines and their safety and the importance to public health. So to start with, James, we talk about scientific literacy. What does that mean, and why is it so important in today's world?
Because we are so inundated with science and technology in this culture, it's very important for every individual citizen to have some basic level of scientific understanding. And I don't necessarily mean go to college and take a chemistry class, but be aware of a lot of the scientific information is out there, and at least be able to go to places where you can trust the information that you're getting. We have the entirety of the internet as a resource, but there's a lot of places where you can get good information and a lot of places where you can get bad information. So it's important to be able to know exactly where to go to get the right information.
Okay, so pseudoscience. We're going to talk about pseudoscience, and I have a feeling most people don't know what that term means. It might sound to some people like it's got something to do with science fiction.
Well, a lot of times it does. I mean, if you think about all the science fiction aspects, the media that we have, the shows, you know, a lot of information is presented as scientific. You know, just take Star Trek, you know, a lot of all that interesting future scientific technology, how much of that is actually developed into fact? So you go back all the way, you know, we first had things like cell phones or things like tablets, and now we have them today. But pseudoscience is more something that looks scientific or sounds scientific, but is not necessarily based in scientific fact. So one of the big major situations that sort of reference in pseudoscience is astrology. So, you know, thinking about how star signs relate to our everyday lives, and people think, okay, movements of the planets are going to affect our day-to-day lives, but really it doesn't. You know, and there are a lot of other things like creation science, you know, which are meant to, are presented as scientific fact, but really are not based on the scientific method. What's a bigger issue these days is companies, particularly that are in the idea of getting a profit for a product, are going to take a little bit of cherry-picked scientific information as presented as these big grand studies and say, well, there's this. We can use this as a basis to make a scientifically based product, in quotes, because it sounds like they're providing scientific information, but it's really not correct, scientifically supported information.
So it's really their ability to put a spin on their product.
Right.
That's based on perhaps one study, but the broad knowledge base in that field doesn't really provide weight to that one study.
Right. The cliche for me is, you know, 4 out of 5 dentists support this particular, you know, I don't want to give a particular product, but, you know, one of these toothpaste. Mm-hmm. Well, a lot of times you see these companies taking, oh, we'll take that one, the one that disagreed, and then we'll base a product on that and say, well, here's the one guy that disagreed, then we'll use that to sell the product rather than the majority that supported the other product.
I see. And I think another example that you and I might have talked a little bit about in the past is this whole thing with supplements.
Oh, yes.
Everybody's taking fish oil, chondroitin sulfate. Yeah.
So it's important to note that the FDA, the Federal Drug Administration, does only do scientific testing for pharmaceutical drugs. Mm-hmm. They do not do any testing for supplements. So there are some private companies that do testing for supplements, but other than that, there is no rigorous studies done on these. And so recently we've seen studies come out in relationship to things like fish oil that say there's really no benefit to taking these, but we have all of these marketed supplements going back years that say, oh, if you take this particular supplement, you're going to get this beneficial effect, mm-hmm. where the studies do not simply support those things. You know, going back to my past, we're talking about St. John's wort, which had a vogue, you know, 20 or 30 years ago, or something like echinacea, which also had a similar vogue, and it was, oh, if you take echinacea, you won't have to worry about getting a cold, except that there's no mm-hmm. evidence that echinacea ever had any benefits. Same thing with St. John's wort in affecting mood. You know, it's sort of hit or miss, and you don't know whether or not it's anything more beneficial than the placebo effect.
So that's interesting, and this is something we hadn't talked about. Were those based on any piece of scientific evidence, or were they based on extrapolation of saying this contains this active ingredient, so therefore it must have an effect?
Well, sometimes these are based on like local herbal medicine. So if you go back to like ancient Chinese medicine, or you know, any part of the world, this particular herb was thought to have this particular beneficial effect. Mm-hmm. And sometimes they're marketed without studies. Sometimes there are studies that show there may be something, you know. And it often depends on the size of the study. So if you tested on 100 people, you could get one result, but if then you tested on 10,000 people, you could get something very different.
Right.
And you don't know if the proper controls were used, you don't know if there are multiple things, you know, multiple chemicals within those herbs that are actually doing what they're supposed to do. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of different levels of this that we could get into if we wanted to, but the idea is that if there are studies that tend to support it, they're really not sure whether or not this particular herb is actually beneficial or not.
Okay. So going back now to scientific literacy a little bit, how much knowledge does someone need to have to be able to make an informed decision around their own health or other science-related issues, and to be able to separate the science from the pseudoscience?
I think a lot of it has to do with sort of basic understanding, not just of science, because you could have a little bit of scientific information, you know, whether it's self-read or you've taken a class a long time ago, but because there are so many other aspects to this, because you have the economics of this, when you're talking about products, you have the psychology, you know, a lot of these are going through, a lot of these companies are going through advertisers, so, you know, they can prey on specific language. So it's also language, so you have your English. Mm-hmm. So there are different pieces of this that sort of come together. So you don't necessarily need to have a PhD in science mm-hmm. to understand this, or even a BS. You know, a little bit of light reading can get you a lot of information in terms of, okay, I know what a chemical is, I know what an atom and an element is, I know certain things do certain reactions, you know, and that's all you really need to know, and then you can, as long as you have that basis, then you can read and process the information properly. But it's not simply, and this is what I tell to my students, it's not simply about the science. You have to understand all the different aspects that come into mm-hmm. play to sell a product, you know, and how people react to that. And so there's, you know, particularly the psychological aspects of things are very important.
And it gets back to the critical thinking skills that we try to get our students
exactly.
up to speed on.
Yeah. Yeah, so, you know, and it's sometimes strange for my students. I think, you know, they're expecting to come in general chemistry or organic and just get all of the scientific information mm-hmm. that's in the textbook. But to me, I don't think that's enough. You know, we're training mm-hmm. citizens here.
Yes.
You know, it's critical thinking, it's a liberal arts education. They need to know more, because if they're just going out with the scientific information and don't know how to process it mm-hmm. properly and recognize it properly, they're not going to be able, they'll be taken advantage of just like anyone else.
Mm-hmm.
So it isn't just about the scientific information, it's a sort of greater understanding of how the world works, really.
Interesting. So how you started talking a little bit about your classroom and what your students expect, how do you incorporate this stuff into your classroom? What kinds of activities do you do with your students so that they really get to understand this scientific literacy?
Well, in the very beginning, when I first started teaching, I always wanted to include a lot of different media. So I was showing YouTube videos and internet mm-hmm. articles, and then I sort of gravitated towards, well, there's a lot of junk science or pseudoscience being talked about. This is a way to get students engaged in topics that are outside necessarily all the information that I'm presenting them. And so now that a lot of students, if not all the students, have some kind of device that they can do internet mm-hmm. searching, we actually do projects in class where I have them say, okay, find some pseudoscience for me. And if they're having trouble, well, I'll provide them a topic like the anti-vax movement or climate change, you know, or something else that sort of generates a lot of skeptics. Mm-hmm. You know, and so now they'll know, okay, a lot of the websites that you bring up when you do a search, a lot of them are going to be giving you a lot of false information. Where can you go to get good information? So that's sort of a basic activity that we start off with, and then it usually builds to some kind of major project. These days for me it's a video project, where then they either need to create a product that they have to sell, or they have to take a product or some other situation, a situation that's out there, and debunk it and say, okay, this is what you're being told, this is what the actual science is. Do those things match? You know, because it's entirely possible, well, this product does what it's supposed to do, even though it does sounds kind of outlandish, maybe it does what it's supposed to do. That's not usually the case. You know, and we've had products like spray sealers, you know, where they spray them over a grating and say nothing goes through. Well, it doesn't actually work that way, and my students actually did some experiments to prove it. So that's the kind of thing that I want to train them to do, is to think about what kind of BS, if you allow me to say it, is out there, and so be able to see past it and see what's really happening.
I see. So you're really engaging them in science at that time.
I would hope
so.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's great. That's great. And in terms of the websites, do you do a lot of, do you talk a lot about, you know, now this website is likely not to be a good one because it's sponsored by X versus this, that's the NIH-sponsored website or the FDA-sponsored website?
I try to do that. I have to be a little bit careful because there's a lot of anti-government sentiment out there, you know, even among our students.
Ah.
So even when you tell them, oh, this is the FDA, this is the NIH, oh, but wait, that's the government.
Interesting.
You know, so I do tend to come across some anti-government sentiment, and I say, well, look, one of the things that you can trust is it based on peer-reviewed scientific information? You know, and a lot of them are not really sure exactly what that means, so then I have to go back and say, okay, this is these are peer-reviewed papers, this is the, say, American Chemical Society, or a journal like the Journal of the American Medical Association, and say, this is peer-reviewed science, this is what peer-reviewed means. If you can find references on websites, whether they're government or not, this is something that you should be able to trust. And because you can bring up those papers and actually read the basic scientific information.
I think your audience might not all be aware of what the term peer-reviewed means. Before we go on, that's, I think, in light of some of what you're going to talk about later, it's important for people to understand that.
So you mentioned my graduate work right at the very beginning. And so when I was in graduate school, it's all about papers, publishing papers. So you do your work, you do your research, you know, and you talk to your advisor about it, and you want to write a paper, and you submit it to a journal, so Journal of the American Chemical Society. You submit it, and then they have peers, what would be experts on that particular subject. And so it's a group of 3 to 5 to 10 people who read the work and are able to analyze it based on their own expertise and see whether or not the science is good, whether procedures were followed. Has there been any plagiarism, which is often a problem? And then, you know, that is part of the publishing process. And then they will recommend if it's good science, if they think it's good science, they will recommend to the publisher saying, this is good science, we should publish this and let the world know of this good science work. So, and it's really specific in terms of experts. So if you're doing research on the oak leaf, then your paper will be submitted to experts on the oak leaf. So it's, you know, peer-reviewed, really peers, not just a chemist and another chemist. It's a chemist who is an expert on the reaction that you are working on.
Right, so a panel of experts are vetting your research or what you've written in your paper.
Yes.
And that is going to be really important, I think, as we continue talking. So now let's get to that topic that I know you're passionate about, and it really helps us to understand why scientific literacy is so important and how pseudoscience can actually impact people's thinking and actions. There's this big national conversation around vaccines, to vaccinate your children or not. How did this conversation begin? Where did it come from?
There was a medical doctor in the UK in the late 90s who published a paper that suggested a connection between the MMR vaccine and autism. And it instantly created a firestorm, and ever since there has been people who have thought there was a link between vaccines and autism, or vaccines and other diseases also. It was mm-hmm. none the only one. It turns out that this particular doctor falsified a lot of information. He was paid, and not from the typical sources, so it's important to note that scientists also get grants, mm-hmm. you know, from private or public sources, but he was getting sort of paid under the table. He was going to be developing a company that was going to take advantage of this connection. And it was also a very small study. As I recall, it was only a dozen or two people, children that he was following, and so that really doesn't represent a large group. But even so, the paper was published. You know, and you know, I will say the peer review process does have its flaws. And again, you know, and this was before the 24-hour news media. So mm-hmm. again, it created mm-hmm. a firestorm. People said, "Well, we can't take vaccines because they'll cause autism." Well, it turns out studies since then have shown that there is no connection between vaccines and autism. We don't understand what autism comes from, where mm-hmm. autism comes from. You know, it's an ongoing process, and the psychology is people who have autistic children, they want to know what happened, they want a cure, mm-hmm. you know, and, mm-hmm. and that's a natural aspect of this. Mm-hmm. And so they, when they see information presented like this, they immediately say, okay, we have a reason. Right. Except that isn't, there's no connection, so there really, that wasn't the cause. But even, you know, once, you know, it's kind of like a virus, once you put mm-hmm. that into the system, it's very difficult to get it to stop. And so even now, 17 years later, we have huge pockets of people, not only in the United States, but other parts of the world, that are not vaccinating their children based on this one study.
Interesting. So a faulty study led to the idea that vaccines are dangerous, even though there have been other studies that have shown that is not the case. People are still holding on to this. I think you addressed this a little, but it goes back to your earlier comment about scientific literacy, including understanding some of the psychology and that sort of thing. So do you think that's why people are holding on to these studies, this whole idea of they want a reason, which of course happens when any of us have children or siblings who have a disease, or we do, we want to know why we have it, because if we understand why, maybe they can fix it for us.
That's only really one psychology.
Okay.
You know, there are those people that want blame, but you know, that's more of an emotional response.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you have a lot of people that are very much into the green, organic, natural route. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's a different psychology, and will refuse not only vaccines but pretty much all Western mm-hmm. medicine. You have people that are very much the anti-government, you know, anti-control aspect uh-huh. to say, you know, and there's conspiracy theories out there that say, well, the government wants us vaccinated not to make sure that we don't get polio or smallpox or other things like that. It's because they're actually injecting us with, you know, micro recording devices. You know, there's those mm-hmm. kinds of people out mm-hmm. there too. You know, so there are a lot of different reasons why someone may maintain an anti-vaccine
okay.
psychology. So it's not, you know, if we were trying to sort of counteract these psychologies, there's not one silver bullet, you know.
Right.
Something released from the American Chemical Society recently was, how do you argue with an anti-vaxxer? And there's really not one way, because there are all these different psychologies that are at play. You know, so you really have to understand where the person is coming mm-hmm. from in order to talk to them. And then there are just the people who would contradict you just because.
Right.
You know, and then those are the people that, if you present them with the scientific information, will just dig in their heels and resist you
right.
further.
Right. So what is it about vaccines that people think are harmful? Is it the deactivated virus itself, or is it something else?
Well, there are people who believe that, you know, you are going to get sick because it's still the virus or bacteria or toxin present. But a lot of the misinformation has gone towards some of the other materials that they add in. Mm-hmm. You know, because this is a biologic, you have preservatives. There's a preservative called thimerosal that contains a mercury atom. You know, and if you don't have that basic scientific understanding, you might equate it with the silvery metal that, you know, mm-hmm. scientists have always played with. It's not the same thing. There is a mercury atom, but when that thimerosal is broken down in the body, it is passed through and does not bioaccumulate like other mercury compounds can. There are adjuvants which help the immune response that are based in aluminum. Again, people have targeted that. But none of these compounds have been shown to affect anything related to autism or any other disease.
Okay.
It's important to note that thimerosal, after this all happened in the early 2000s, was removed from most vaccines as a preventative measure by the FDA, even though there was no reason they needed to do so. So most vaccines don't even have it anymore. So anyone who actually brings that up, again, their information is flawed because it's not in most vaccines.
Interesting. And there probably is also an aspect of the quantity of these additives that are in the vaccines.
That's also, but again, they're typically in such small amounts that they really couldn't have any effect. You know, there's a lot of discussion about, are there any toxic materials out there? Well, everything has the potential to be toxic. It's about the dosage. You know, water can be toxic, whether you drink too much or you drown. You know, so it's about how much your body has the ability to process, and what we're injecting, the body has the ability to process and excrete out.
So there's a really important element to all this that we've talked about, and that is the public health aspect and the public health threat in some ways that the anti-vaccine group is really bringing forward in some ways. The whole talk about the herd mentality, the herd aspect of vaccination.
So there's the idea of herd immunity. So
yes.
You know, if there are certain people because of their immune systems that cannot be vaccinated, they wouldn't have the ability to process the vaccine properly. They would get sick, and that's understandable. However, those people are protected based on the people that are surrounded are also vaccinated. So if you build up a wall of people around a sensitive person who are vaccinated, it greatly diminishes the possibility of being infected. And so the more people you have as a society that are vaccinated against any particular disease, the less likely you're going to have infections. But if you have huge pockets of people that are not vaccinated, and somehow that disease gets introduced, immediately you're going to have a lot of people coming down and being sick. And that was the case last winter with the measles. And so there was that outbreak that was based in Disneyland in California, where unfortunately in California you do have a wide area, pockets of places where people are not vaccinating their children. And so when you were exposed to a lot of kids in a small space, like a daycare or an amusement park, someone has it and there's not kids that are vaccinated around them, they're all going to be exposed, and a lot of them are going to get sick. And that's what happened. You know, a huge group of people were not vaccinated against the measles, and a lot of people were sick.
And I think it's interesting to note that people might say, "Heh, the measles, you have them and then it's done." But there can be serious outcomes of having the measles.
Yeah, and it's not just the measles. We could think about smallpox, too. Chickenpox. Well, smallpox, too. But chickenpox now, it remains in your body. And so now we have all these advertisements now for shingles later on. Measles can be mild. It has the potential to be mild, but it also has a lot of side effects. And one of them can be encephalitis, swelling of the brain, which can lead to death. You know, and the incidence rates of encephalitis is not minimal. It's 1 in 1,000, I believe. You know, so that's not a small risk to take. You know, but there are people who think, well, that's not even a big risk. You know, I'll just get sick and I'll get better. But that's not always the case.
So what do you think it's going to take? You said that there are going to be people who will dig in their heels. People believe these things for lots of reasons. If it was your job, if the Public Health Service hired you to go around the country to educate people about this, what do you think you could tell them that could change the mind of at least some of them?
I think some people will be willing to listen to reason. If you present them with the scientific information, I think at least a few people would be willing to listen and say, well, maybe I was wrong. I was listening to the wrong sources. If I'm presented with the proper scientific information, I know that it's better to be vaccinated. There are some people you're just not going to reach, whether you are kind or aggressive. Some people will just not come along to your way of thinking. So you have to try to reach out to the people who you may believe can change their opinion, you know, and it takes listening to people, and I think that's one of the things that we are not doing a very good job of these days in society. There's a lot of people talking, but not a lot of people who are listening properly. And if we could be better listeners, we could find the right words to say to those people and say, look, it's okay that you were thinking this way, but here's the proper information. Mm-hmm. I want you to rethink what you have done previously and maybe you'll change.
Mm-hmm. So let's go back. You talked about people who just can't be immunized. Some of it may have to do with some illness that they might have that they just can't take a vaccine. But there are other reasons that we, from a public health perspective, we want as many people as possible to be vaccinated.
Well, it goes back to herd immunity. We want to make sure that we want to eliminate these viruses because, you know, the more diseases that are spread, the greater the pressure it is on the health system. You know, and if people are coming down with diseases that we should have been eradicated or minimized, mm-hmm. again, one, we might have lost the ability to treat those. You know, sometimes those things are forgotten. But again, it's better when people aren't sick. You know, we don't want to be sending people to the hospitals, mm-hmm. to doctors, to add pressure to the healthcare system. Mm-hmm. You know, so there are a lot of those sort of economic reasons that we want to have vaccines out there because, well, people don't put pressure on the healthcare system.
Right.
So keep them healthy. You know, it's better for everyone. You know, right. We don't want people getting sick. So that's just, you know, it's not just a health aspect. It's the economy, too. You know, all of these things sort of mix together.
Mm-hmm. So I think another example recently is vaccine for whooping cough. And there's been some resurgence of that. We have about a minute and a half left. Can you talk a little bit about this whole idea of resurgence?
Well, there's a couple of aspects to that. There are some scientists who think that we're developing sort of an immunity to the immunity, you know, that our bodies need a booster. And there are vaccines out there that require boosters. Mm-hmm. So whooping cough is not one of those that's been thought to need a booster. So now we're seeing more outbreaks. So now in the teenage years, it's suggested of getting whooping mm-hmm. cough. Also, parents of or caregivers for small children, you know, because small children can't get that vaccine right away. So getting again the herd immunity around those children to make sure that they're getting protected from anyone mm-hmm. who might have it. Mm-hmm. You know, so and there are going to be other diseases out there that are related to vaccines that will constantly be studied and say, well, maybe we need a booster, maybe we need a better vaccine. You know, so there's a lot of ongoing studies being mm-hmm. done here. So, you know, again, we should be having these conversations, but positive conversations,
right.
not necessarily dealing with a movement that is causing so many problems.
Right. So in the last minute, I'm going to ask you a question. I know you have a 2.5-year-old son. Has he been vaccinated?
Yes. He has followed the full vaccination schedule. So another thing is don't give all these vaccines at once. Again, there's no evidence to support mm-hmm. that's a bad thing. He's fully vaccinated, and so are my wife and I.
Mm-hmm. And your wife and you, so that you're not bringing illnesses home to him.
Right, including the flu vaccine.
Aha, And you're a little young to be getting the flu vaccine, based on what the indications are for the flu vaccine.
Better safe than sorry.
Yeah. Any last words in the last few seconds?
I'm not here to tell you to get vaccinated. I'm here to tell you just to get the proper information and be educated. So I am not a medical doctor. I just want people to be able to get the right kind of information.
Read the right information and use your critical thinking skills.
Exactly.
Okay. Thank you, James. This was really, really interesting, and I hope explains this issue and gives people a better understanding of it.
My pleasure.